Well, good evening, and welcome to this production of Ye Are the Branches, the exciting story of the life and times of Hudson Taylor and his ministry to the Chinese peoples. Please be so kind as to silence all cell phones, and we would also ask you not to exit and enter during any of the scenes. There will be an intermission later on where you will be able to move about then. Your job for now is to sit back and enjoy the life of Hudson Taylor.
When foreign missions was still in its infancy, J. Hudson Taylor faced seemingly insurmountable obstacles to take the gospel to the people of China. However, he learned very early that these obstacles could only be conquered through God's power. He was often heard to say, "He is the vine, and we are the branches." This is how he lived his life. And it is what later caused him to say, "God's work, done in God's way, will never lack God's supply." Even before he was born in 1832, Hudson's parents had a burden for Chinese souls, and they often prayed that their son would be called to serve there. When they saw he was a sickly child, they quickly abandoned their hope, yet continued to instill in their children a love for the Chinese. After, when Hudson did accept Jesus Christ as his savior as a teenager, the Lord called him to China. Despite his poor health, Hudson began to prepare immediately by studying Mandarin, Greek, Hebrew, and Latin. He devoted his time and his resources to the poor, determined to live only by faith. Nothing would stand in his way. Not even a close call with death during medical school when he contracted a deadly disease as a result of a simple pinprick. He lived on prayer. Finally, when he arrived in China, he faced situations such as stolen possessions, no food, few friends, and the turmoil of civil war. All of these he faced with prayer. In time, the Lord blessed, and people began to accept God's gift of salvation. After only 6 years of mission work, alongside his faithful wife, Maria, Hudson's failing health forced them to return to England, and there he founded the China Inland Mission. Tonight, we join the Taylor family and a group of fellow missionaries as they return to China aboard the clipper ship, the Lammermuir. The voyage seemed to go well until near the end, when the ship was forced to sail through several typhoons, resulting in 15 solid days of perilous weather. On one particular night, the ship seemed all but lost. The waves crashed up on deck, and the sailors were ready to abandon their posts.
No use! Rutland. Not when. My stomach isn't in rhythm with the sea. And with the typhoon tossing the boat like a shuttlecock, I fear we'll never reach China.
Sit for a while, Emily, and breathe deeply.
Come, beside me. We'll supervise the working folk. We have the perfect qualifications. A sprained leg and a weak stomach.
I'm so weak.
Then sit there and decide whether you're going to hold that box or your stomach. We're being broken in, all right. I pray God will live out this voyage. God's worked among the crew during our trip in bringing some of them to salvation. And he's worked for our best also in using us to bring them the gospel. We better make sure everything is secure.
He's right, Nicole. We should stop complaining and thank God for the souls he saved on board ship.
Ah, yes. But there's one that he'll never reach. That rotter Brunton.
I don't know. It seemed like last time Taylor talked to him, he softened up a bit. Oh,
why he wastes his time on such a hopeless...
No one's too hard for God to reach. You know that.
You know that if God reaches Brunton, Taylor is going to take all the credit.
That's not true, and you know it. Come now, you can't keep on holding this grudge of yours against Taylor.
I did not come to the mission field to be treated like a child. He'll not make me a fool in a Chinese jacket.
Well then, let's have another go at changing his mind.
He's a stubborn mule.
He believes in wearing native dress on the field, all right.
Mr. Taylor, you must come to the top deck. The crew's scared. They won't man the ship. If they mutiny, I'll be forced to shoot.
But Captain!
The ship's taking water. She can scarcely hold for 2 hours without the crew. We need everyone to cooperate.
Captain, I've been something of a chaplain to the men. Well, let me speak with them.
Come on.
Journeys on boats not nearly this large.
Yet I'm so sick.
Is it really God's will for us to go to China?
Yes, Emily. I'm sure of it. I can see more clearly every day God's direction. Gracie Taylor, where have you been? You were supposed to be minding Bertie.
I'm sorry, Mama. Bertie was asleep and I thought I could help.
You've a missionary's heart, Gracie. Praise God for that. Now back to baby brother. And Gracie, don't leave him again.
Yes, Mama.
I'll have a look at Bertie too.
Maria, you'll never believe what just happened. Brenton's been saved.
Oh, Hudson, when?
Just now, up on deck.
What a cause for rejoicing.
It is. But at the same time, I'm ashamed.
Of what?
That I would ever doubt that God could change his reprobate heart.
Hudson, these past 3 months at sea have been a strain. But when we're on land again in China...
I wonder, have I made a mistake in bringing back a defenseless little band of missionaries all the way to China?
We waited on the Lord for the decision.
Yes, but I have fears that they'll break down or starve or worse, and then they'll reproach me because I'm responsible for them.
Isn't Nickel and his friends for making you feel this way?
I'm weary of their arguments against wearing the Chinese clothing.
They're new to the work. With your understanding and encouragement, they'll mature in their attitudes.
Pray for me. I'm easily annoyed. Perhaps I've been too harsh with them.
Sometimes your frustrations lead to abruptness, but I've never known anyone to long for God's fellowship like you.
I want to serve him, but this me keeps getting in the way. Sometimes it's unbearable, this spiritual dryness. I thirst that he might increase and I decrease. Why, up on deck just now, I flared up when the sailors were afraid to rescue Brunton.
What?
I haven't told you yet, but Brunton was lashed to the helm to keep him from being washed overboard with the waves. A stern sail boom cracked and it fell on him. We cut him loose and bandaged him up, but most importantly, in his utter distress, he called upon God.
I can scarcely believe it, but I must say I'm well rebuked.
God has really changed his heart. When I bandaged him up, he said, "Now I'll not rest till the whole merchant navy knows of the savior I found."
Mr. Taylor.
Captain Bell, come join us.
We could use a few strong backs up on deck.
What can we do, sir?
Well, the storm's over, but we need to lash the cargo down. And we've got to begin mending those torn sails.
All right, we'll be right up, Captain. Men, we're needed up on deck.
Mr. Taylor, one thing first. We need to talk to you.
I already promised the captain we'd help.
Mr. Taylor, it's about our clothes.
Now is neither the time nor the place.
And I'm not pitching in with any more work until I'm fully satisfied on this issue. Our wardrobes are nothing like what we'd expected them to be. They have little similarity with the other church missionaries.
If you lack anything on our list, I'll supply it.
Hudson, I'm no longer a simple blacksmith tipping my hat to the gentry as they bring in their horses. I at least demand a decent wardrobe.
Men, before we left for China, you agreed to follow my leadership. And the mission's principle is that to the Chinese, we be Chinese. We have to begin by wearing their clothing.
Excuse me, Mr. Taylor. One of the men has taken a bad fall from the rigging.
I'll be right up.
Aye, sir.
But how can you be sure you're right?
Men, I've learned from past experience in China that to be respected by the Chinese, we have to wear their clothing. We can't allow personal preference to interfere.
But it's not conventional.
I agree. Other missionaries may even mock us. But men, there are 400 million souls in China. 1 million a month dying and going to hell without a savior.
Now
tell me, which is more important? Our pride or their souls?
Now, Mr. Taylor, really?
We aren't going to China to denationalize, but to Christianize. Men, I've pled with you before to find the answer to this question. Why are you going to China? Please, lend a hand where you can about the ship.
What will you do now?
Nothing. So make the best of a bad arrangement. What tyranny not to allow my wife to wear her hair in a net, to shave me of my beard? What right do the tailors have to tell me what I can and can't wear? I've had nothing but trouble from them since we left England.
What are you talking about?
We've been shamefully treated.
Disagreeing with him is one thing, falsely accusing another.
My wife has not been able to leave our cabin since we began this voyage. I mean, really, how can the tailors tell us what we can and can't do? I'm smart enough to know that a woman in Western dress is going to receive much more respect than if she were in Chinese clothes. I mean, the Chinese men despise their own women. Mrs. Taylor even said so herself.
I won't believe the Taylors have mistreated either of you. They've been gracious to all of us. Mrs. Taylor has treated us like one of her own family. And if she's done...
She treats that rotter Brunton better than she treats me. He'll have us groveling to those savage Chinese. I'll not have him giving me orders like that. I may be a low-born blacksmith, but I'll not have Hudson Taylor putting foreign clothes on my back.
Hudson Taylor and his band of missionaries survived the trip in the Lammermuir and arrived safely in Shanghai. They traveled down the Grand Canal and established a mission at Hangzhou. The question of dress continued to be a dividing force among the missionaries. This constant battle against Hudson Taylor's leadership distracted the missionaries from the work that they had been called to do. Though there were occasional victories, no amount of pleading on Hudson Taylor's part could destroy the unity that had been lost between the missionaries.
Mr. Nickel was ill.
What's wrong with him?
The message didn't say, but Hudson feared it might be serious.
I admire Mr. Taylor. That would be hard for me to treat Mr. Nickel with such love, knowing that he's against the mission's policies.
Harmony among us requires love. My husband has sacrificed himself to the life of the mission. You see, I admire him too.
Papa's work is very important. I hope God has helped him to do what he wants and that he'll come home soon.
Are you still dizzy?
Yes, Mama, but I want to stay up until Papa comes home. May I?
Of course. Papa's the doctor, and he'll coax the sunshine back into your cheeks.
Mrs. Taylor, cow is not better. The fresh milk soon be contaminated for children to drink.
Contaminated, Jung Kang? Contaminated. Has Birdie been teaching you English again? Well, Mr. Duncan can Dr. Bessie if Mr. Taylor doesn't arrive first.
Mama, why do we call Bessie?
It's her name, just like we call you Birdie.
Are all cows named Bessie?
No. Why?
Because Bessie was the name of Mr. Duncan's cow back in England.
Your memory is better than mine, son.
But Mrs. Taylor, even if Chinese don't drink cow milk, cow is Chinese cow and should not be doctored as England cow.
Very well. But if Jung Kang gets Chinese fever, he must now ask Mr. Taylor for England medicine.
When will Mr. Duncan return?
Not until after the weekend. If he can get a boat without any difficulty, I suppose he'll return tomorrow afternoon.
Well, with Sue along, they should have no trouble communicating with the Chinese.
Her language instruction has greatly aided the men in adjusting to being in China.
And they do look a good deal more respectable in their Chinese clothing.
Now they're just like Chinese gentlemen.
Although Mr. Nickel did do his very best to keep his English trousers from going into the trunk.
Our new wardrobes are so practical, though I had some misgivings before leaving England. The Chinese do respect us women just as much in our Chinese clothes.
Hello, everyone. Hey, Bertie.
Hudson.
Hi, Gracie. Oh, it's good to be home.
How's Mr. Nickel?
He's better. I've just been in to see the Rudlands.
What news from them?
Their work is growing. I think they may be able to move on to Hank Chow by the end of the summer.
That's encouraging, Mr. Taylor.
Yes, and just now on my way through town, the Lord prompted me to stop by Mrs. Wong's again. Yes, Gracie, the apple lady. You know, what you said to her about her need of a savior made her really think. And just now when I was over there, she accepted Christ as her savior. I wish that you could have. Are you warm, Gracie?
It alarms me, Hudson. She loses her balance, and sometimes she just fades off as if she's unconscious. Other times, she can't sleep. Yet right now, she seems to be improved.
Look at you. Has she complained about bright sunlight?
She's not been outside.
I wanted to play outside. Mrs. Shu gave us a new kite. Maybe tomorrow Bertie and I could fly it.
You have a temperature, Gracie. Your head, does it hurt?
Sometimes, but not now. I must be getting well.
Well, some cool towels will help keep your temperature down, and I'll get you some medicine that will make you less restless when it's time to sleep. Can you climb the stairs to your room by yourself? See you later.
Night, Gracie.
Good night, Emily, could you take Bertie to bed?
Yes. Night, Bertie.
Night, Bertie.
Nickel's better, you said?
He wasn't even sick.
But
simply depressed. A foreigner in a new country.
But you were able to encourage him.
To remind him that we walk by faith and not by sight, and that we look to God and not men for our strength.
How did he respond?
Still, I sense a lack of unity, of true unity. His attitude hasn't changed a bit, and I can't trust him. Yet when I see his weaknesses, I see my own. Oh, Maria, the irritation of a day and a half, no, 3 days of travel, just to nurse a homesick missionary. Sometimes I feel so ineffectual in this work.
God chose you because you were weak enough to seek him.
I wish I could understand. Whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst.
We've come to fight Satan, and he won't leave us alone. Hudson, the cow is sick.
Oh, Maria, you're both my doctor and my medicine. Has Duncan looked at her?
No, they're not back yet. Duncan and Sue, I mean.
Well, then, as official doctor in this house, I'll treat cows as well as people.
But you'll check on Gracie first, won't you?
You're really apprehensive about her, aren't you? Her face was swollen, but the fever was the only symptom, and I can't be sure what that indicates. Very well, I'll check on her first and then Bessie.
Sir Taylor, come quick!
Duncan! What's the matter?
Sue is bleeding! Mandarin beat Sue!
What happened?
I am so sorry, Mr. Taylor. I do not wish to bring trouble to you.
What is not Sue, Mr. Taylor? Sue says it's Mr. Nicole.
But why?
People feared missionaries. People went to Yemen. Mandarin come and beat me with bamboo rod and leather strap.
Why would they do something like that?
Mr. and Mrs. Nickel wear English clothing.
Nickel, where is he now? And Duncan?
I do not know. Mandarin say, leave Sao San.
Come, let me help you.
I'll show you where.
I know this house. I know Mr. Taylor.
Louis, this calamity, it's...
Hudson! These people have no respect for us. Had we stayed in Sao San, the both of us would have been beheaded.
The anti-missionary, anti-foreigner feeling is growing amongst
my them. Feeling for these heathens is mutual. They have no respect for us. And I believe the reason for it is your silly policy of making us wear these Chinese clothes.
Now, Louis.
From now on, I'm going to wear trousers, grow whiskers, and use a fork and a knife like any normal civilized human would.
God has called us to labor for the good of the Chinese people.
We have no friends among the other missionaries there. They mock us.
Then we must force wear the company and the approval of Westerners to gain the confidence and the friendship of the Chinese. After all, Christianity isn't a Western religion. It's for everyone.
Mr. Taylor, the authorities in Siosan hate us.
But men, the people listen to the gospel. I've prayed that God would send forth laborers, that men would be unable to remain in England.
We've already left England and come to China.
What do you ask of us?
Give God everything. Then, like the Apostle Paul, go to an unreached province, start a work and see it grow. Then move on and let the Chinese take over after you're gone. But you have to begin by wearing the Chinese clothing. You can't allow pride to get in the way.
Hudson, never, never again am I going to dress myself like a fool like that.
Before we left England, you agreed to these very principles.
And I still remember my signature on that document. But really, Hudson, honestly, how will these people ever respect us when we wear English clothes, then Chinese clothes, then English clothes, then Chinese clothes? This whole thing is ridiculous.
Your course is dangerous.
Well, then I had best make my way to the nearest open port.
Well, that may prove to be the best course. But don't act rashly. Let prayer make your decision. If we're not broken up altogether, it'll be of God's own special interposition.
Mr. Taylor, the Mandarin did mistreat Nickel. They mistreated all of us. Hudson, you've been like a brother to me since we first met, but could Nickel be right on just this one issue?
George, Lewis may mean well, but he doesn't understand the Chinese.
But the respect we deserve as English.
The Chinese deserve just as much respect as any of us. Our labor is a labor of love, both for Christ and for the Chinese people. We're all exhausted. We'll get some rest tonight and we'll talk some more tomorrow. Five years and longer I've worked in China. Solid principles, I've seen them bear fruit.
Nichols prided himself as an Englishman. I barely held my peace. He poisons all those around him.
Even George, I fear, agrees with Nickel against us.
Oh, Gracie, with all the interruptions, I'll go up.
No, I will. I've got to think and write a few letters.
But you should rest.
I know, but I need to keep a close check on her fever. And if anything particular develops, I need to be right there.
Very well. Good
Gracie, Gracie, let your family doctor take a look at it. Your father? No! No! Maria, come quick! Gracie, no! It can't be. No! Maria! It's too late. I couldn't tell. Diagnosis was impossible. Gracie! My little girl!
Gracie.
Don't go! Father! You promised we should never thirst!
Mr. Taylor, one question if you do not object.
Yes.
How long have you known this good news in your country?
Why, for hundreds of years.
My father, he died without hearing this good news. Thousands of Chinese, my people, die without hearing it today.
Yes. And I pray the day will come when scores, no, hundreds of believers will be here working amongst your people here in China. Come back in 2 days. We'll look at your arm and perhaps we can talk further. You too, Mrs. Wong, can be a missionary to your people here in China.
For 6 weeks, pushing himself to the limit. 100 patients a day, preaching to hundreds.
He worked too hard. When I come today, Mr. Taylor already took out nice elbows.
The sun never rises without finding him at prayer. Let's clean the dispensary tonight. We need to do more to share his burden.
I'll wash instruments. Since Gracie died, he threw himself into work night and day.
I miss her smiles, especially when I have to face Mr. Nichols' dark looks. If he had left the mission, he would have caused less ill feeling. I'd better prepare Mrs. Taylor's medicine.
Oh, Mrs. Taylor, is she better?
Her strength is giving way. She suffered more than we'll ever realize. Yet there's still a smile on her face.
I pray God make her well. I'll give my life for her and Mr. Taylor.
And they do the same for you, for any of us.
No more sick bodies waiting to see the strange missionary doctor. No more broken arms or legs to fix. Maria, stop your puttering around. I'll get Maria's medicine.
Mr. Taylor, if I leave, you'll work till daybreak. And I haven't finished wrapping the bandages or sweeping the floor.
Oh, let tomorrow's tasks be done tomorrow. Take some time for vacation.
Very well. I'll mix the medicine in. Relax tonight.
Jung Kang, there's a fireworks show going on in town tonight. Why don't you go attend?
Oh, Mr. Taylor, too much work to do. Scrub floors, scrub dishes, milk cows. No time for flower work.
Both of you, come on, take some time for vacation.
Mr. Taylor, we'd rather stay.
No more talk of it. Go on, both of you.
Very well.
Good night, Mr. Taylor.
Good night. Hello, George.
Yes. Mr. Taylor, I received your letter and I've come for my papers.
I wish there could have been a better way. It's been 6 weeks.
Well, I was hoping that, I was hoping the Chinese would have made some formal apology for what they'd done to us English. They never did. They sent us some gifts, a teapot, some silk, some fans. They never apologized for what they'd done to us.
Louis, you don't understand the Chinese culture. They're a very, very proud people. And it takes a lot for them to humble themselves. Especially to a foreigner. And above all, they must not lose face. I can see I've made the right decision. Wait here. I'll return with your papers.
You seem friendly. Things are not as they seem. He's not moved an inch from his original position. All I know is that as an Englishman, I deserve a measure of respect.
And I know I'll not be responsible for splitting up this mission.
Mr. Nichol, how do you expect the Chinese to turn to Christianity?
Well, you tell them of it, of course, Mr. Taylor.
Well, what have you done in the past 6 weeks to bring them the tidings of redeeming love? It's no use singing, waft, wafty winds the story. The winds will never waft the story, but they may waft us.
Now, Hudson, I object to these kinds of implications.
And I object to your refusal to abide by the principles of this mission. I object to your refusal to wear the Chinese clothing. I object to your taking my time 6 weeks ago. I keep thinking to myself, might Gracie be alive today had I not been busy pampering missionaries who aren't worth their salt.
Oh, so now you would dare accuse me.
But more than that, I object to the kind of missionary endeavors that end up with English chapels and English services, with a foreign English air connected to every aspect of their work. Mr. Nichol, I repeat what I said aboard the Lammermuir. I want to see Chinese churches, pastored by the Chinese, filled with Chinese converts and worshiping God in their own tongue. You have refused to abide by this most essential principle of God's work, and that's why I've asked for your resignation.
see these savages fawning the other church missionaries. I deserve and I demand more respect than that.
Well, perhaps you'll get it in England. Good day, Mr. Nickel.
Mr. Taylor, I'm so ashamed that I listened to Lewis. He told me you've been spreading slander, but really, he's the guilty one. He hasn't been concerned for the Chinese people. He's only been concerned for himself. And I realize today that, first of all, we've got to humble ourselves before God and earn the Chinese's respect.
Yes, George.
And also, I never told you how sorry I was when I heard that Gracie...
No, I understand. Thank you. Let's talk tomorrow. Maria, you've written a letter. Mr. Nickel, it has been 6 weeks since my darling Gracie died. Perhaps I should not write, but I cannot refrain. Has the thought not come to you that if Mr. Taylor had not been treating your imagined ills, and at the most crucial time in treating you to amend your ways, he might have been able to detect Gracie's disease? Was he not giving preference to members of the mission whose proud and arrogant spirit is not indicative of a missionary's heart?
I couldn't send it, Hudson. I couldn't send it. How I miss her sweet voice. Has it been worth it to lose her?
Maria, she's not lost.
If we had stayed in England.
She's in the better land now. We wouldn't have her back again.
No. She's far happier than she ever could have been here.
Lewis Nickel came for his papers tonight.
I couldn't trust myself to speak to his falsehoods to you in the mission. Whispering accusations, spiteful, outright lies.
We may have lost Lewis Nickel, but just now, George Duncan came and asked for my forgiveness.
You've been a brother to him and the others, a father to some.
They've not always interpreted my actions that way. Maria, every day, every hour almost, the consciousness of failure oppresses me. I pray, weep, agonize, resolve even, all to no effect, that I should feel this way as a child of God. Oh, Maria, I never knew how bad a heart I had.
Hudson, I know you love God.
I could have written this letter. I speak unkind words. I have hard thoughts. Oh, Maria, the continual striving to enjoy communion with God.
You've encouraged others to cast their burdens on the Lord because He sustains.
How slowly I learned to imitate my precious Master.
If we believe not, He abideth faithful.
He will never leave me.
Never.
Never will. I am the vine. You're the branches. Abiding. Not struggling or striving. Maria, the answer's been here all along. I don't have to have faith or strive to increase it. I can let my Savior work His will through me, looking to the ever-faithful One, who's all we need for time and eternity. Oh, Maria, things may not always be as I would have them, but if God permits them, I can be content.
These too, Martha.
But Mrs. Taylor.
No, they're yours now. When you have your first child, you'll be prepared.
I'm so sorry about little Noel.
He just wasn't strong enough. Only 15 days old. Folded and ready. I wasn't well enough to attend the funeral, but I chose the hymns. I need you here, Martha. I'm so thankful you've come.
I just can't help but think that maybe William and I, we shouldn't have come.
You had no choice. You were forced out of town.
Well, now that we're here, what may I do for you?
Perhaps you could begin by taking over the correspondence. Emily, that would leave you free to supervise the dispensary.
Certainly, Mrs. Taylor.
God's given us such willing missionaries. Since Gracie's death, he's been weaving us more closely together. Where's William?
Bringing in the luggage from the boat. Mrs. Taylor, Martha and I had better help the men with some of the lighter luggage.
If those rioters outside could do what they wanted, there'd be precious little hope for us.
Mr. Taylor! One of them threw a rock through the window. This message was tied to it.
All foreigners must leave town. Attack is coming. Murderers die. Well, the mission's weathered the storms of men before.
But those were English men. I love the Chinese, but I dread to think...
God has always been equal to our emergencies.
Hudson! Where's Birdie? I heard breaking glass and shouting from the street. Birdie!
Maria, you should be up in bed. Doctor's orders.
But I can be useful down here.
Emily, would you please be see that Birdie is safe? Yes, sir. Rudlin just brought a message in that indicates there might be trouble. Perhaps we should send Birdie back to England.
You spoke of it before.
Yes, but with the hot summer coming and the unrest as it is, I think that might be a wise choice.
How soon would he have to leave?
There's a boat that leaves tonight.
Not tonight, Hudson.
Only if necessary, but... with your health the way it's been, and with all this rioting going on, I think that's the wisest decision to make.
Perhaps you're right.
The men need me outside. I must go to the Mandarin. They have to give us protection. Is Mr. Tanner here?
He just left for the Mandarin.
Mrs. Fan, tell us reason called us.
Chinese fear foreigners. Think foreigners are devils.
They think that Hudson Taylor is a devil?
Cut out eyes to make medicine. Steal children from town.
God thinks missionaries take 24 children out of town.
How can they believe that?
Missionaries give pills from devil. Make convert eyes shine. You hear that? Crowd is angry. Missionaries eat babies. Foreign devils!
Barricade the door. Everyone else, up the back stairs.
Foreign devils!
Oh, Maria, I keep thanking God that you're safe. I wasn't sure any of us would survive the attack last night.
Bertie's with Emily. Well,
shh. Don't speak. Just lay still.
Was sent Bertie to England. My head's so hot. Tell Bertie to be good, to obey Miss Emily, and to love Jesus.
Maria, your medicine, it's still here on the cabinet. Giving you to me. They knew we'd need each other here in England, or in China. Maria, your strength, it's giving way.
I feel no pain, only weariness.
Maria, I fear you're going home.
I'm so sorry.
You're not sorry to go to be with Jesus.
No, it's not that. But to leave you here at such a time.
We've had 12 and a half years of happiness together.
God will be with you. And we all yearn.
Father, I need you more than ever at this time. Teach me that you are the vine, and we are the branches.
After Maria's death, Hudson's grief almost consumed him, though his burden for the Chinese never lessened. His sorrows only seemed to multiply as he began to suffer from physical ailments. Further problems arose as support lessened on the home front, and he soon found it necessary to return to England to garner help and support. He found that the Lord had not deserted him. However, within a short time, he had raised the support he needed and met Jeannie Fallon, who would become his second wife. In 1871, he returned to China with his new bride. Did Hudson continue to encounter need and hardship? Why, of course he did. But these things were far outweighed by the blessings of serving his Lord. At the time of his death, in 1905, Taylor left behind the China Inland Mission with 825 missionaries living in all 18 provinces of China. The mission was comprised of more than 300 mission stations, more than 500 local Chinese helpers, and at least 25,000 Christian converts. Year 2015 marks the 150th anniversary of the China Inland Mission. Hudson gave his all to win the Chinese to the Savior. He sacrificed his health, his means, and his family to win souls for Christ, and never regretted it for a moment. Taylor himself said, "If I had 1,000 pounds, China should have it. If I had 1,000 lives, China should have them all." No, not China, but Christ. Can we do too much for him? Can we do enough for such a precious Savior?
What a life, this Hudson Taylor. Truly, it was a life of commitment, going so far as to even dress like the Chinese so that he could win them. It was a life of courage, never shrinking back from duty, no matter the difficulty, nor from opposition, whether within his own missionary ranks or from without. Most importantly, though, It was a life like Christ. He did not go to the Chinese to Europeanize them, but to Christianize them. He emulated Christ, and he lived to share with them the life that Christ died to give them and to every person on the entire world. Our prayer for you tonight is this. For those of you that know the Lord as your Savior, we hope that this production will inspire you to a life of deeper dedication. And for those of you that know of Christ, but you don't know him yet personally, our plea is that tonight you'll turn from your sin and make the Lord Jesus your King and your Savior. Support this production of Ye Are the Branches by making a donation. There's a box at the bottom of the stairs, or do like I did and buy a pizza card. For only $10, when I go to Papa John's, I order a pizza and I pay for it, and they give me a second one absolutely free. So I was able to get my card early. I've made use of it several times, and I think it'll be useful to you as well. On behalf of Fairhaven Baptist Church and Fairhaven Baptist College, I'd like to thank each and every one of you for being here tonight. And I don't know about you, but I want to see this cast of characters one more time. So I'm going to ask them to come out here.
Coming out tonight, but also we do want to thank Mrs. Schreiber. We'd like to call her up here. We have a couple of gifts for her. She's the one that helped put all of this together. We would like to give her a big thank you for all of her work and dedication and the time that she put into this play and putting up with us for the last several months. So. For coming tonight, and we hope that you enjoyed the production.